Let's begin. So it is a real pleasure to have Tina Eliassi-Rad here. Tina joined our external faculty just 2 years ago, right?
Yeah.
And so she is a colleague and a wonderful researcher with very broad interests in network science, machine learning, and also issues of ethics and fairness in both AI and network science. She's a professor of computer science and the Joseph Eun Chair, President Joseph E. Eun Chair at Northeastern. She's a core member of their network science faculty. In addition to an external faculty member here, she's also an external faculty member at the Vermont Complex Systems Center. She was previously an associate professor at Rutgers. She got a PhD in computer science and mathematical statistics at Wisconsin-Madison. And also this past year, she received multiple honors, including being elected fellow of the Network Science Society and the Lagrange Prize, which is a very prestigious prize in interdisciplinary science and complex systems. So welcome, Tina. We hope to see more of you early and often.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chris, for that kind introduction. And I would like to point out that all the good things that happened to me was after I became an external faculty at SFI. And that was because Chris nominated me, so thank you very much. So you are the source of all this goodness that has come my way, and I appreciate it. So I'm going to talk about trustworthy network science. You may say, well, what is trustworthy network science? I know what network science is, right? We're interested in representing phenomena as complex networks and then building predictive and descriptive models of them. Why do I need this trustworthy thing? Well, the reason is because machine learning is now being used in many of the applications of network science, and both of them are being used in life-altering decisions. So, for example, machine learning was used in the network epidemiology models during the pandemic, and so on and so forth. So, also in misinformation, et cetera, in terms of modeling misinformation. So what is a machine learning tool? Network scientists oftentimes view machine learning as just a tool, and that's just fine. So you have some tasks, you collect some data, you come up with some mathematical or statistical model. This is just a simple feed-forward neural network, artificial neural network. Then you need to learn the weights or the parameters on this artificial neural network. So you pick a loss function, and you pick an optimization algorithm to find the parameters and the weights for you. So far, so good. What trustworthy ML is about is that I care about my model to have not only good predictive accuracy, but I also want it to satisfy some other properties. For example, maybe some notion of fairness. I would like it to be stable. I would like it to preserve some privacy, some notions of privacy. Perhaps I want to for it to be causal, so not just correlations. And maybe I want it to be explainable or interpretable. And if you're interested in trustworthy machine learning, there is a superb professor, Hima Lakarajo at Harvard, who runs this Trustworthy ML initiative. And you could go there and learn a lot more about trustworthy ML from tutorials all the way to advanced material. So when it comes to trustworthy network science, it's similar to trustworthy machine learning, except that now your data is represented as a complex network. It could be a simple graph, it could be a simplicial complex, it could be a hypergraph, but it's your data is in a data structure that captures some form of relational dependency. That's basically what it is. And so, I have two big research thrusts in my lab. One is AI ethics and complex systems. The other one is this trustworthy network science. We've been working on many different topics that fall within this subfield. And of course, I won't be able to go through all of them. I'm going to only talk about one work on stability and another one on reliability. If you're interested in others, here's a list of recent papers. We can talk about it, or you could just go and skim them from my website. So first, obviously, we would like our machine learning tools that are being used for networks to be stable, some notion of stability here. And I'll define it formally in a minute. So the question that my student David Liu and I posed was the following: how sensitive are node embeddings to graph perturbations? So for example, you give me a social network and I embed the nodes of this in a lower dimensional space, and then you give me another social network that, let's say, is a subset of the first one. How different are the embeddings of the nodes that were present in both of these social networks? So the background on node embedding, and sometimes people call it graph embedding, but that's something different. So to be clear, node embedding is you give me a graph, and my job is to embed the nodes in this graph in a lower dimensional space. Usually, computer scientists like Euclidean space, so it's mapped into some Euclidean space, and the dimensions of that Euclidean space D is much less than the number of vertices that were present in the graph. And it's usually because computer scientists like powers of two is some power of two. Now, common uses of the node embeddings are, for example, node classification. If you give me a social network and you have labeled some of the nodes as bad and some of the nodes as good, but there's plenty of nodes that I do not know their label for, then I can use these embeddings to label the unknown nodes. Link prediction is another one. Clustering or community discovery is another one. Now that I have my nodes in this lower dimensional space, I can do clustering, like k-means or whatever else you like. And then also for planning purposes, think reinforcement learning, for example. I can use these node embeddings to reduce my search space in reinforcement learning. So they're used a lot, and computer scientists treat them as gossipable, right? Like, okay, you know, if Tina was in this social network and you embedded her here, that's where she is. Like, that came from God. This is her location. So the motivation for us to study this was that obviously real world networks, and I'm going to use networks and graphs interchangeably. I know that that's not a good thing to do, but I'm going to do it anyway. So real world graphs are incomplete and noisy. You're not omniscient. You're oftentimes operating on an open system, and you're only seeing part of the phenomena. And then the other thing that we all learned in our first course in numerical analysis is that it's useful to know how much the output of your algorithm changes if you make changes to the input, right? And we all have seen something like this, for example, in a shower. You hit the knob, and now all of a sudden, you know, the water is super hot, for example. So the original question was, how sensitive are node embeddings to graph perturbations? Now, this is too abstract, so we modified the question to the following. How does the embedding of the nodes in the degenerate core change as the periphery of this graph is removed and we re-embed the nodes? And I'll show you a picture that will make this clear. But first, some background. I think most of you know about K-cores and the degenerate core, but just as a refresher, K-core is a maximal subgraph where every node in that subgraph has degree at least K. And the degenerate core of a graph is the K-core with a maximum K. And the K-shell is a set of vertices that is part of the K-core but not part of the K plus one core. So here, the blue nodes are part of the one core but not the two core. So they're the one shell, yeah.
So I haven't heard the word degenerate used this way before. So like in that graph, the degenerate core would be that little fork link?
Yes, yes, and I will show examples of real world graphs with the degenerate core. Yeah,
why is it called degenerate?
I have no idea why it's called degenerate. I just took it as gospel because I'm a computer scientist, and I think Kleinberg used it somewhere. I don't know. But you may say, why should I care about the degenerate core and the stability of its embeddings? So far, okay, so the degenerate core is a dense subgraph. Maybe, in fact, it's a clique. So in earlier work that we did with Ki-jun Shin, who's now a professor in Korea, and Christos Feloutsos, we showed that the degenerate cores are not cliques. They actually contain non-trivial structure, like core periphery within them. They have communities. They are where a lot of activity in the graph happens. So you should care about it. And then in other work, that both we and Lou, this is not David Lou, another Lou, and Leisharam, we did this work. We showed that in particular with like marketing applications, removal of a node in a dense subgraph can trigger a cascade of node removals. This is called the anchored K-core, if you haven't heard about it, where you have an anchor in a K-core. That anchor doesn't satisfy the degree constraint, but when you remove it, a majority of the nodes in that K-core go away.
Does that have anything to do with marketing?
Oh, this is because usually you're trying to sell something like recommendations. You could do it also for other kinds of applications, but the initial motivation for studying the anchored K-core was, you know, recommendation at targeting, so on and so forth in online communities. So that's why, you know, just giving some background about where all of this comes from. I mean, most people who work on the web are interested in either misinformation or basically some form of recommendation.
Or recommending misinformation.
Yeah, there you go. Together, finally, at last. So then, a work that I really like by Barbera et al. And the senior person on that work, you may know, Sandra Gonzalez-Balian at Penn. They show that when it comes to online activism, like hashtag Black Lives Matters, et cetera, the core nodes rely on the periphery to amplify their message. So if you think about it, if you think about people in the core, they typically have high degree, et cetera, et cetera. They really need the periphery to be able to pass on their message, et cetera. So looking at it in terms of how the node embeddings change as I remove the periphery for the nodes that are in the degenerate core is something that, you know, is interesting to look at. So how are we going to evaluate stability? This is Karate Club just on its side. And I'm going to embed it with this method called Node2Vec. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Node2Vec. It has had, like, I think 10,000 citations now by the time it came out. It came out less than 10 years ago or maybe. But anyway, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the Karate Club and I'm going to embed it in this two-dimensional space. The nodes in the degenerate core are colored blue. And so this is where everything falls when k is equal to 0. Then at k equal to 1, I get the same thing. Right, k equals 0 and k equal 1 for the K-cores are the same for the Karate Club. At k equal 2, the embeddings get flipped, but the distances between the nodes remain fairly the same. At k equals 3, okay, they're still the same, just they move a little bit. And then at k equal 4, which is the degenerate core number for Karate Club, all of a sudden the position of the blue nodes that were in the degenerate core are very away from each other, right? Or far away from each other. The scale here on the x and y-axis are exactly the same. Now you may say this is exactly what I thought should happen, which is fine, but hold on. I will get to why you should care about this in a minute.
Can I ask a technical question?
Yes.
So I thought that Node2Vec was, I mean, I'm not that familiar with it. But are these flippings a real change, or is that, I mean, is it, but it's a...
It's not a real change. It because what Node2Vec does, and I have a slide on it, is that, so you do these random walks around every node to get its context, and that will be its sentence. And then those sentences are then sent to a skipgram, which is like a word-to-vec kind of a thing. And then you get your embeddings. But this is like, to me, this is fine, even though it got flipped. You know, perhaps you have something that can deal with this kind of a change. The big thing is that the blue nodes all of a sudden are very far away from each other.
But sorry, let me rephrase my question. Is Node2Vec equally happy according to its own objective function if I flip the...
It is fine because, like, if you think about the applications that they're used, they're like link prediction. So, like, who's closest to you or clustering or something. But I will get to some of the problems with it. So, I am not here to praise the node embedding, like Node2Vec or any of the node embedding methods. Maybe I should have said that.
I see a difference between k equals 0 and k equals 1. I look at that and I
Because the graph doesn't change, because I don't have any nodes that are disconnected.
Okay.
Yeah. So how are we going to measure this peeling instability? And of course, there are many different ways of measuring instability. This is what we picked, and you may not like it, but it's my show, so this is what we picked. So what we're going to do is the following. We're going to take the nodes in the degenerate core at every K core, K0, K1, K. At K0, I look at the nodes in the degenerate core, and I say, how far are you from the other nodes in the degenerate core? So I'm going to do this degenerate core pairwise distances. I get a bunch of distances. Now I can come up with an empirical distribution of distances between the nodes in the degenerate core. And again, you may say, why should I care about these? I hope that I convinced you that maybe they're interesting in your network because they have a lot of connections, right? They remain as you peel or shave the graph. These are technical terms that people oftentimes use. So for example, if this is a 2D embedding and these are all the nodes in the degenerate core, then I could get this kind of pairwise distribution. And if this is their embedding, then I could get this, right?
Sorry, is this the distance in the graph or the distance in the embedding?
Embeddings, distance in the embedding space. Thank you for that clarification. So then what we do is we define the instability in terms of the earth mover distance between these empirical distributions of the nodes in the degenerate core in the embedded space. That's all I'm doing, right? So I embed the nodes. I'm only interested in the degenerate core. What is your pairwise distances? I get a list of numbers. I find an empirical distribution, k equal 1. Then at k equal 2, I do the same thing. And then I do the earth mover distance, right? It's like Wasserstein metric. It's just like how much of, quote unquote, earth do I need to move from this pile and add to that other pile to make the distributions similar to each other. It's a term that I don't know if engineers or computer scientists came up with, but if you think about distributions as hills, right, how much earth do I need to move? So what did we do? We picked up, so now I have a way of measuring instability. And so we picked up a bunch of data and a bunch of algorithms. Now you may say, well, why these data sets and why these algorithms? But before I tell you why, I just want to tell you, so this is for, these are the number of nodes, these are the number of edges. This is the max K in the K core in these networks. This is the percentage of the nodes that are in the degenerate core. And this is the edge density of the degenerate core. That's what you're seeing. So we picked our data set, the set of data sets that we picked to span these two dimensions. So in the y-axis, we have the max K, the graph's degeneracy, as it's oftentimes called. So we wanted to pick a bunch of data set that span that scale. And the x-axis is the maximum core link entropy, which is the degenerate core well connected to the outer layers of this graph, or is it not, right? And so that's how we picked our data. And yes, of course, you know, we don't cover everything. We didn't put a grid on it and say, okay, for every grid I have something, but we feel like we have a good representation here. And then the algorithms that we picked, this is a really nice paper. It's by the folks at the Google graph mining team, and the lead author is Ines Campi. And so I really like this picture about like a taxonomy of various graph embedding. Again, this is really node embedding, even though they call it graph embedding. And the algorithms that we picked is we are in the unsupervised realm. We do not have a teacher to tell us labels about the nodes. I do not have attributes on the nodes. I don't like content on my nodes. I just like the structure. So we don't have attributes to confound our findings. And then we're looking into these kinds of what is called shallow embedding, though we add a couple of things that are not technically shallow. But we have a method from the Laplacian, a method from the non-Euclidean hyperbolic, method from matrix factorization, and method from Skip Graham. And so if you're not familiar with these, I'll have a summary slide, and then a few of them that we use, I'll tell you a high level overview of them. So we, PCA has been around for like 300 years, right? It embeds your nodes into a lower dimension in a linear fashion, right? So you could give it the adjacency matrix and minimizes the reconstruction loss. Its optimization method is eigen decomposition. The similarity method is Euclidean distance, and this is time complexity. Then you have methods that operate under like graph factorization, which is similar. You're doing the adjacency matrix. You minimize the regularized sum of squared errors as opposed to minimizing the reconstruction error. You use gradient descent. The similarity in the embedded space is dot product, and that is a time complexity. I'm going to talk about SDNE. This is a structural deep network embedding. It takes the adjacency matrix, it minimizes a regularized form of the reconstruction error on both local and global structures. It uses stochastic gradient descent, it uses Euclidean distance, and that is its runtime complexity. Note2vec that already came up, it generates these random walks to generate context around every node, then it minimizes conditional log likelihood of a node's neighborhood. It uses stochastic gradient descent with negative sampling. This negative sampling is very important. I'll mention it at the end. And then it uses dot product as similarity in the embedded space. People like HOPE a lot. This HOPE doesn't use an adjacency matrix. It makes a similarity matrix. So for example, you would do the CATS measure on every node, and then you would come up with a similarity matrix between the nodes. And then it does minimize reconstruction error. It does something like an SVD, dot product, et cetera. And then,
The CATS measure?
Yeah, like, you know, how many walks do I have? How many paths do I have from me to you?
Okay.
Kind of stuff.
Okay.
And then the last one is GLEE. This is our method. We use a Laplacian matrix. We do minimizing reconstruction loss. It's SVD and then reverse dot product. So this notion, like whenever you look at an embedding method, if there's one thing you take from this talk, is basically, what is the input graph representation? What is this objective function? What optimization method it's used? And what's the similarity or distance measure that it's using in the embedded space? These are all important things. And if you care about scalability, perhaps the time complexity of it.
And sorry, I also don't know what the reverse dot product is.
It's just a minus sign in front of the dot product. It's just the way that we do it.
Okay.
Yeah. So Laplacian eigenmaps, I'm sure you all know about it. It's one of the most popular ones out there. You take the Laplacian matrix of a graph and you solve this generalized eigenvector problem. Z is the embedding, is your node embeddings. You put some constraints around the Z to remove some of the problems that you could get with scaling and trivial solutions. And so the idea here in English is that the Euclidean distance in the embedding space of two nodes should be close to each other if they were close in the graph space. And in many of the node embedding methods, this is their guiding light. The guiding light is that if you and I are close in the graph, in terms of number of hops usually, so some geodesic distance, then you and I should be close in the embedding space. And there are some issues with this that I will highlight, which is people cherry-picking performance measures, which is very interesting. So this is another one, structural deep network embedding that people use all the time. Here they embedding of the node is this Y. So Y of I is embedding of node I. And this looks complicated, but it's actually not complicated at all. So the first thing that's doing, it's saying minimize the reconstruction error for the adjacency matrix. And then it's multiplying it by this B because it's calibrating the reconstruction error. It says that if you get a one in the adjacency matrix wrong, you should be penalized more for it than if you get a zero wrong, right? And one of the things which is interesting with these things, and I'm sure for all of you who have played with machine learning tools, your results really depend on the hyperparameters. So this alpha and this nu is a hyperparameter. If I set these to zero, then basically what this structural deep network embedding is doing is calibrated PCA, right? And depending on how you pick B, then it's just doing PCA, right? This is not clearly said in the paper, but this is what it is. Then you have this term, the second term, which is penalty of mapping nodes that had a link to each other in the graph far away from each other in the embedded space. And then this is hyperparameters. These are basically you do by having like a validation set, or you pick it out of the hat, and that's what they suggest in their paper. And then there's the last part, which is obviously you're learning a lot of parameters, right? So what are all your parameters? You're learning a parameter matrix where the rows are the number of nodes that you have, and the columns are the number of dimensions you picked. So if you had a million nodes, you have a matrix with a million rows, and if the number of dimensions were 256, you're trying to learn an entry for all of those, right? So you're trying to learn many parameters, so you would like to regularize it, right? You would like them, for example, to be small. And they use an L2 norm for the regularization here. Now, in embedding methods, you oftentimes hear this first-order proximity and second-order proximity, and just so there's no confusion here, first-order proximity is just the strength of an edge between node I and J, like your weight, if you have that, and the second-order proximity is basically measuring some notion of Jaccard, whether it's basically normalized, like intersection over union, like Jaccard index is, or just intersection. So then Notovec, this is the one that was published in 2016, and I think it has like close to 10,000 publication citations now, is where, as I said, for every node, you do a random walk around it to get its context or its sentence. Then when you have this sentence for that node, then you just use, you borrow from natural language processing, and you use SkipGram, which is part of word to vec, right? So now that a node is being treated as a word, I'm just going to borrow from the NLP people, and I get my embeddings.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
I mean, so do I take one random walk for each vertex?
Yeah.
So, but surely that's handing off to this other method, the word to vec, a very random choice of which walk I happen to take.
Yep.
Which it seems like an odd choice, as opposed to saying, I want some weighted information about my neighbors, my neighbor's neighbors, and so on, rather than this one randomly chosen path.
Yeah, so you could do, yeah. I mean, it does have some hyperparameters that you could tweak in terms of like how often you come back to the node and do another set of walks. So it does have a hyperparameter that you could set where it's not just one. It's multiple, where you come back to yourself, like a random walk with restart or a personalized page rank kind of a thing, right? Where you could come back to yourself with certain probabilities, but with a certain probability. But those are hyperparameters, and like how you pick them, there's lots of issues.
So, I mean, historically or sociologically, it seems like the reason why people chose this was because there was this thing called word to vec, which
yes.
Strings of symbols.
Yep.
So there was a desire
yep.
to use that as a subroutine to
yep.
give a string,
yep.
a single string to each node.
Exactly. Okay. You could even do like an egonet, right? Everybody's, the one thing with the egonet is that you won't have these fixed size sentences, right? Again, because you're going to give it to this artificial neural network, you need a fixed size vector as input. And I'll talk about that too. There's problems there too. Yes. You could have them be weighted, but for the majority of the work I'm talking about, we're assuming they're unweighted networks. Yeah. Okay, so just giving you some sense of what these methods are that are really popular out there, whatever. So what are the patterns we found, right? This is the network science part of it, patterns we found. So one is that the embedding of the nodes in the degenerate core are sensitive to the removal of a specific K-shell, and I will shed some more light onto that. The second one is that we saw that the embeddings of the nodes in the degenerate core for Erdős-Rényi and Barabási-Alber random graphs were stable, and we know why that is. I will tell you in a minute. And the third one was, as the periphery is removed, this pairwise distribution of the placement of the nodes in the degenerate core becomes smoother. It becomes less multimodal. And we have a conjecture for that as well. So the first one, just an intuition. So as I said, there's a point of instability. What I'm showing you here is the last FM social network that was collected in March 2020. These are Asian users, and the connections are mutual who follows whom, right? So I follow you and you follow me, kind of a thing. And on this side, what I'm showing you is the probability density on the y-axis and pairwise distances on the x-axis. This is, again, distances in the embedded space. And the different curves tell you about the different k's, as in the k-core. And one thing that you should see is that at k equals 13, something happens. Like, everything was basically following each other. That is, the distances between the nodes in the degenerate core wasn't changing. All of a sudden, around 13, and there was a shift, right? And here, I'm showing it to you with hope. Remember, hope takes in a similarity matrix. And number of dimensions, 10. So I'm mapping the nodes in the last FM into a 10-dimensional space. And we tried this with all the other algorithms, and all of them also agreed that around 13, something happened to the pairwise distances of the nodes in the degenerate core. And I will talk more about this in a minute, but I'm going to talk about pattern 2 and 3 next. Pattern 2 was that we didn't observe this kind of shift in the ER and the BA networks that we created. The reason being is that in the ER and the BA networks that we created, the degenerate core is a big part of the graph itself. And so we did not see this kind of instability. But for example, with the block two-level Erdős-Rényi graphs, if you don't know about them, they're one of my favorite graph generators. It came out of Sandia. Basically, you create a bunch of dense Erdős-Rényi graph, and then you connect them together so that you get a heavy tail distribution. And you can give it both the triangle distribution and the degree distribution of your graph. We didn't see that in the block two-level Erdős-Rényi graph. So this is not a phenomenon that we're seeing just because they're synthetic graphs. It's that if you have a graph where the degenerate core is composing the majority of your graph, then you're not going to get this instability. And that kind of makes sense. The last one was that as we remove the periphery and we get closer and closer to the degenerate core, we see that these distributions kind of smooth out. And our conjecture here is that as I get, so the periphery aren't uniformly connected to the nodes in the degenerate core, right? But as I remove them, I'm taking away that heterogeneity. And so the pairwise distributions become smoother. So the hierarchy, this layered hierarchy, is removed. So let's go back to this point of instability that we're seeing. On the top, you're seeing the Facebook social circles data. And you can download all the data from our paper, and we got it from others. So the last FM and the Facebook data is part of Yuri Leskovich's Snap repository. So if you look at the top here, Facebook, this is k equals 70. This is k equals 71. I'm showing you Laplacian embedding with d equal 10 dimensions. Obviously, I can't show you all the 10 dimensions, so I'm mapping the nodes in the two-dimensional space. Here, the degenerate core nodes are colored in red, and something happens when you go from k equals 70 to k equals 71. And so what I'm showing you here is the various k's for the k-cores. And on the y-axis, I'm showing you different features of the graph. So for example, what is the edge density? What is the size of the degenerate core? What is the average clustering coefficient? And one of the things that you see is that around 70, the edge density jumps up. That is, when I go from k equals 70 to k equals 71, the edge density goes way up. And we see this also in the last FM from 20 to 21, where the edge density moves up. Now, we did this small regression analysis, and we see that for the majority of the methods, they're saying that it's the edge density that you should look out for this change in the point of instability. And we have a small theorem in the paper that for Erdős-Rényi graphs, for Laplacian eigenmaps, as the degenerate core becomes bigger and bigger. So as the edge density increases in this for the, so let me back up. So for Edestrian graphs with Laplacian eigenmaps, which it has its own loss function, which I showed you, the difference between them is less distinguishable as edge density increases. So that's basically, so the worst loss and the best loss become the same as the edge density increases. So can we make an existing node embedding algorithm robust to this kind of peeling instability? Yeah.
So I certainly don't know about the details of these different node embedding algorithms, but I assume that what they're sensitive to is the fact that if you and I are both in, even if we're both in the degenerate core, if a lot of paths between us go through shells of lower degree, we remove those shells.
Yeah.
Well, then the actual graph distance between us changes, you know, things like the resistance between us can change. And so is that what's going on? I mean, is that what all these things are sensitive to?
Yeah, that's very, yes. Yeah. So that's what our conjecture is as well. And at the end, I'll show you something that will follow up on that. Yeah.
And if the core is sort of one clump, if there aren't like noticeable different structures in the core so that different core members all talk to each other through the core,
yeah,
then it wouldn't notice.
It wouldn't change. Exactly. Right. Exactly.
And somehow that happens in some popular synthetic models.
And also real world networks, which I will show you in a minute.
Okay.
So can we make an existing node embedding algorithm robust to this peeling instability? And people love their node embedding methods. So for you to push a brand new node embedding method, it will take a monumental task. So we're like, keep your node embedding method. What we're gonna do is we're just gonna add a new term to your node embedding method if you care about this kind of instability that will penalize for unstable embeddings of the nodes in the degenerate core. And so what we picked for this loss is this first order proximity where what we're saying is if two nodes are embedded close to each other in a higher K, then you would like them to maintain that distance in the lower K, right? Which just goes back to what your intuition was now. In a way, what we're saying is use the nodes in the degenerate core or any nodes that you really like, that you care, as anchors, and then build the other embeddings for the other nodes around these. Now, you may say, well, like, why this addition of this loss function as opposed to something else? There are tons of out there. So we have three reasons that hopefully you'll find good enough. The first one is, I go back to the paper that we had in 2016, which we showed that, look, the degenerate core is actually an interesting subgraph to look at. And what I'm showing you here is a picture from that paper where looking at various networks, you could see that, for example, in terms of modularity and the core periphery structure, they are diverse. You're not just getting a clique. The second one was exactly as I was just saying, which is basically you're going to get an initial stable embedding for the nodes in the degenerate core or the nodes that are important to you. And then what you're going to do is you're going to use them as anchors, right? And that's basically what the addition is. The addition is if me and Chris are close to each other and you have deemed us important in a higher K core, then we should try to keep that distance between me and Chris in the lower K cores. So you may have some questions. One is obviously in these high dimensional space, it's famously known that similarity doesn't really make much sense. And for us, the dimensions that we use has to be less than the degeneracy of the graph. So everything that I've shown you is not a huge number, right? So, you know, similarity still does make a sense. I always get this question like, okay, well, what is the complexity of computing this pairwise distances? Obviously, it is the number of nodes in the degenerate core squared. But as I will show you in a minute, the number of nodes in the degenerate core are very small. You should be able to handle doing an n squared operation there. And then the last thing I always get asked is, what is the runtime complexity of finding the degenerate core? And that's linear in the number of edges in the entire graph. So I'm going to show you some performance metrics. One of them is area under the ROC curve for link prediction. This is something that is used often in machine learning, data mining, graph mining papers. And the idea here is that, look, if you look at what your method would do versus what the stable method does, the area under the ROC curve are similar. So it's not like you're getting your performance hit by imposing this penalty for instability. But one of the things that you oftentimes don't see, and I'll give you a reference for where this idea came from, is that for precision at k, and here I'm showing you precision at k equal 5, these methods do horribly wrong. So how are we computing precision at k? The whole idea behind this embedding is that if you and I are close in the graph space, then you and I should be close in the embedding space. So the idea is that of the five or the k nodes that are closest to me in the embedded space, how many of them are in my community in the graph space, right? And here, the notion of a community is something like edge density, right? Like, you can think of it as, like, you and I have more connections to each other than nodes that are outside of our community, or you and I have more connections to each other than random connections, right? And they do horribly poorly, right? So when it comes to a ranking measure, they do horribly poorly. But in the machine learning papers, you only see this, right? And they're like, look at this. Look how well we do on link prediction. But then on ranking, which is very similar to link prediction, they don't do very well. Like, these numbers are miserable, right? The high, the best you can do, God, is at 100. And, like, you are at 2.48.
Precision at K means what fraction of my top K predicted links are real links?
So in this embedded space, here's Tina. I find the five nodes that are closest to Tina in terms of embedding. And I say, what fraction of these are in Tina's community in the graph? And by community in the graph, I mean something like what Mark Newman would say, community in the graph, right? Some notion of, like, there's more edges between us.
So not whether you're actually linked to them, just whether there's...
Yeah. Because that whole idea is what they're trying to optimize is that if you and I are close in the graph space, then you and I should be close in the embedding space, right? But they are failing this. And this gets me to work by Sesh, who I like very much. His work is amazing. So he had this paper that was published in Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences in 2020. And basically, the gist of his work was that these kinds of dot product low rank models cannot produce the triangle, the rich triangle structure that we see in these real world social networks, where you have both low average degree and a large clustering coefficient. And then in follow-up work in his group, he showed what I just talked about, which is you may do really well on area under the ROC curve for link prediction, but when it comes to some kind of ranking, you do extremely poorly, right? And so then when you are picking a node embedding method, you should think to yourself, am I using this for ranking? And if I'm using it for ranking, then be prepared to get really bad performance, right? Again, God is at 100 and you're like at 2 point something or 12 something. And this is actually where my student Leo Torres, who's now at Max Planck Institute for Mathematics and Sciences, did, which is maybe we should look at the geometry of the embeddings, right? Most of the people who have looked at, again, you have a graph, you're embedding it into a lower dimensional space. They look at just metric properties as opposed to the geographic properties or the geometric properties here. And so you have angles, you have centers of mass, you have convex hulls. You should take these things into account. And so in a paper that we did with Leo, this is back in, it was published in 2020, we looked at the simplex geometry of the graph. And what we saw was that if you do take the geometry into account, then you're able to do better for graphs that have a large, that actually have low clustering. So, like, for example, for protein-protein interaction networks, also some of these methods do not do well. Okay, so this is my practitioner's guide for this table algorithm that I talked about. Is that if you look at this table, and again, this table is from our work in 2016, I'm showing you lots of different data sets. Hamster is a social network of people who like hamsters. And Catster is a social network of people who like cats. And these are the number of nodes. These are the number of edges. These are the number of triangles. This is the degeneracy of the graph. This is the number of nodes in the degenerate core. And so what you're seeing is that the fraction of the nodes that are in the degenerate core compared to the actual nodes that you have is actually small. So you can't afford to do this pairwise distributions that are talked about. So for a practitioner, whenever I publish a paper, I like to at least have something for the practitioner because somebody's going to pick it up to do something with it, is the following. So if the degenerate core of your graph does not constitute a large portion of the entire graph, like here, lots of these social networks, then compute the k at which you're seeing this peeling instability, the maximum peeling instability. If that k is small compared to the degenerate core of what you saw, then beware of the embeddings that you're getting, right? Because you know that the graph that you got is incomplete and it's noisy. And this point of instability is at a lower k. So you're more susceptible to missing data in your graph. And so either take your embeddings with a grain of salt or use something like the stable algorithm. And in fact, the more and more I think about these kinds of embeddings, really what it is that Tina doesn't get embedded here. Tina gets embedded here within some epsilon radius. And Chris gets embedded there within his own epsilon radius. And you do not know those epsilon radius. And if you want to learn those, then that's additional parameters that you have to learn, right? And there are people who are also looking at, for example, not having 1D in terms of the number of dimensions that you're going to embed your nodes in, but having different Ds for different nodes. So for example, if you have Beyonce in your social network, maybe Beyonce requires more dimensions to be embedded properly than somebody who's not Beyonce, somebody who is, for example, in the periphery. The problem there for machine learning people is that we like these vectors because you're vectorizing nodes to be of the same dimension. So if you're embedding Beyonce in a very large, a very long vector, and Tina in a very small vector, then I have to deal with the discrepancy, right? And I can't deal with that well in the current machine learning models. There are, of course, other forms of instability. So one of the things that we're looking at now with Johan Ugander at Stanford and with my student David Liu is how does these negative sampling, like for example, node to vec requires negative sampling of what nodes were not in the context for Tina, because all the word to vec work that is like, okay, here's a sentence or here's within this window, then you have to have negative samples of who's not in the window. And all of them basically use some form to get their negative sample. They draw it from a Zipf distribution with 3/4 as the value of the exponent. And there's no theory out there. It just gives good results and people use it.
I'm not quite following. What are we actually doing?
So I want to figure out, for example, in the natural language processing settings, right? I want to figure out if I see the word vary, what is more likely to appear after it, right? And so now I have these contexts in which vary happens, and I need both positive examples and negative examples. So I see very well. And okay, so that's a positive example of a word that appears with very, but I also need negative examples, like
never,
like very grape or something, I don't know.
What do we do with the Zipf distribution?
So I need to somehow get negative examples, right? There's lots and lots of negative examples. I don't want to have class imbalance. So somehow I gotta get my negative examples. How am I gonna get them, right? Like very grape, where the hell did that come from, right? Or like, I don't know, very zebra or something. And so you have to somehow get your negative examples. And what's happening is this is happening, right?
So the Zipf distribution is the number of negative examples?
No. You're using a Zipf distribution to get to draw negative. So I want 10 negative examples. How would I pick it? I'm going to say I'm going to pick it from a ZIF distribution of the words, and the exponent is 3/4. Because otherwise, how am I going to? Because I'm not going to do all to all, right? So if my dictionary is 50,000, right, and I only saw vary with 10 words, right? Now I have like all those other thousands of words, and how am I going to pick from those?
So the ZIF distribution is based on how common that word is.
Yeah.
So you're saying it's more useful to tell you a common word, which never comes after the word vary, than a super rare word, or maybe we need a mix, but you know,
yeah.
Tail.
Right. Yeah. And so, like for example, here, what you're doing is a social network and you're using word to vec, then your negative samples, it's better to use wedges, right? Because in social networks, we know that if you and I have many friends, but we're not connected, then we didn't want to be friends, right? We had many chances to become friends and we did not become friends. So this is actually a better negative example in the negative samples that I need, because the machine learning model says, give me negative samples, than this, right? Or if you're doing protein-protein interaction, then depending on what you're doing, like a good heuristic would be L3, right? So three hops. This is a work that came out of Barabashi's lab a few years ago. So we're working on this. And actually, one of the things which is very interesting is that all of these methods do some form of normalization, and it's not clear so there are times in which you don't even need a negative example. It seems like the normalization that you're doing on the vectors, because you get these vectors, right? You can normalize the vectors for. So here's a vector for Tina, and I'm going to normalize it. We like normalizing vectors, right? And it seems that if I just have positive examples and I normalize the vectors, that gets me a long way, and I don't need negative examples. So we have some preliminary results that show that in terms of performance on a downstream task, for some of them, you may not even need negative examples because the normalization is taking you a long way. But this is all like ongoing work. We're hoping to submit in a couple of months. But I have a bee in my bonnet in terms of these kinds of instabilities. And this is, I'm not even changing the graph here, right? This is just like what kind of negative samples the thing sees. And remember, the context is that people who use these embeddings treat it as gospel. Right? And it should not be treated as gospel. You should actually have some kind of uncertainty value, perhaps, you know, as long as you know what that uncertainty means. And then, so I had one more bit that I wanted to talk about, is your machine learning tool actually reliable? That is, did your tool learn what you wanted to learn? And there's a classic example, this is back from the 80s, this paper was published in the 1990s, where the Army in the U.S. wanted to be able to distinguish tanks that were camouflaged and tanks that weren't. And they learned an artificial neural network, and it was doing really well in classification, in this classification task. But then upon further analysis, they found out that what the artificial neural network learned was whether it was cloudy or not. Because all the tanks that were camouflaged was when it was cloudy. And when it was sunny, the tanks were not camouflaged. And this happens all the time. Like you may have read this article about how, oh, we can now tell based on images whether you have skin cancer or not. And one of the models that was paraded around in all the media, et cetera, it turned out what it actually learned was that if you have an image of like a mole and that's cancerous, it's more likely that it's going to have a ruler there. And so it actually learned whether the image has a ruler or not. And so if you are using these kinds of machine learning models that especially are black boxes for example, network epidemiology to give some policy recommendations to somebody, then you need to know whether that machine learning model actually learned what you wanted it to learn. And so here, this is recent work that we did. It's the first author is my student Ion, and it's with the Barabashi lab, where we wanted to do drug discovery, so predicting bindings. I have a bunch of proteins, I have a bunch of drugs and natural compounds, and instead of feature engineering, you're really doing architecture engineering, right? And so you have this complicated machine learning architecture that you're learning. And one of the things that we found with this was that, okay, so I have my trained data. In this case, it's a bipartite network of proteins on one side and drugs and natural compounds on the other. Now, in the testing phase, right, I can be in the transductive setting where I'm trying to figure out bindings or links between nodes that I saw in the training set. I can be in the semi-inductive setting where I'm trying to find a binding between a brand new drug, right, and something I saw, or a brand new protein and something I saw, or I can be in this inductive setting, right, where I'm trying to predict a binding between two things I never saw during my training. And what we found was that in the transductive setting and in the semi-inductive setting, configuration model does just as well as these complicated artificial neural network models, right? So I'm learning all these parameters for all this thing, and I could just use a configuration model and not harm the planet, right? And so why is that? Like, why is it that in the...
I don't think everyone here knows what the configuration model is.
So basically, I look at the sequence of degrees, right? And based on degrees, I'm going to predict who has a binding with whom, right? So what we found is that in these settings, oftentimes you have a huge class imbalance or annotation imbalance, where positive is I bind to you, and negative, I don't bind. And so what the models are learning in the transductive and the semi-inductive settings, they're just going with degrees. And they're not really learning any patterns of, it's because of this molecule that this protein is binding to this drug, et cetera, right? And so you need to be careful with these things. And so for this work, what we did was we actually looked at their data. We looked at the distributions, blah, blah, blah. We have some experts. We're like, okay, are these two, we know that they're not going to bind, and like they're not going to bind. And then in our graph, we say, okay, well, how many hops are you? How many geodesic hops are you from me, right? And so then the negative examples that we picked were, okay, you have to be 7 hops away from me to be a negative example, whereby I know that this drug or natural compound is not going to bind to this protein. So for example, this is an example of a negative sample, right? And then we made some recommendations, went to BU, to a lab there, and then they did some analysis and things came out good. And so we were able to publish in Nature Communications. But the moral story here is watch out. If you're using these ML tools, it may not learn what you actually thought it learned. And so just some takeaway, right? The node embeddings are relative, not absolute. Geometric interpretations of the node embeddings can be helpful. The embeddings of the nodes in the degenerate core may be unstable. You need to watch out for that. Really, the quality of your node embeddings depends on how much of the phenomena you observe. We did a lot of work previously on network discovery of like, okay, if I have $100, who should I ask to bring in more people into my network to be able to do better at the downstream task, whether it's planning, classification, clustering, et cetera. And then watch out for the emergence of these topological shortcuts that I just talked about in terms of like the configuration model. And then lastly, again, I'm just going to put up this slide in terms of trustworthy network science, which is, again, if you're using machine learning, you inherit all the problems of machine learning. So watch out for that. And thank you. I'm happy to answer any questions. And your slides you can download from this PDF online. Thank you. It was so clear. No questions. Fabulous. Oh, it wasn't that clear. Go ahead.
So I understand the idea that we don't, if actually removing a single edge to a network completely changes how we classify our embed nodes, that's, an instability. But you were looking at peeling away entire chunks of the graph. And so it's not obvious to me whether the rather strong definition of stability you were expecting would be desirable. I mean, presumably it's interesting if you and I are both in the core and yet there's a short path between us of very low degree vertices. Mm-hmm. I mean, that seems like not something we want to throw away.
Yeah.
So
Yeah, I guess that, so I mean, and as I think you mentioned in passing, like any algorithm which starts by embedding the highest degree core, the so-called degenerate core, and then fixes those locations and then builds the next level. And then, I mean, that's a thing one can do, and I agree it would be stable. But I don't see why that would be better than something which would use the lower degree vertices, partly to figure out where the high degree vertices, even those in the core, ought to go.
So I guess there are a couple of things here. One is like, one is in terms of applicability, right? Like how worried should I be about this, right? And I guess for us, a lot of it was that people are treating these embeddings as gospel, and they're not gospel. So in this case, for example, there are, maybe you would say, oh, this is just one case. But here, for example, the degenerate core is 22. This is 20. And like the number of nodes in the degenerate core is small compared to the number of nodes in the actual graph. So there are cases in which perhaps, you know, you don't see the entire graph, and there are some edges that, I don't know how many of them, but that you remove that will actually make a difference. It's not like I'm cutting away like half the graph, right? And I am gonna get these kinds of instabilities. I guess the point of the work is the following, whether it's very applicable to many cases or whether it's not, is that you should view the embeddings with a degree of suspicion, right? And you shouldn't just say, oh, it does well on AUC on link prediction, and so my embeddings are good. Because as I showed, like if you do a ranking performance measure, it does poorly. And so if this creates some doubt in people's mind in terms of, oh, maybe I should have embeddings with some uncertainty value or embeddings with like an epsilon radius, and yes, I know that will make my machine learning downstream task more difficult, but just adding some doubt into like these are not gospel.
I guess there are two ways in which low degree vertex can be kind of, there are low degree vertices that are part of a low degree core, but which are still kind of hanging off the higher degree cores in a sort of tree-like blob, a cactus-like blob.
Yeah, these are like anchored K cores. Like I only have degree two, but I hold a lot of people together in the higher K.
Well, right, so I can have low degree and high betweenness or centrality and right, be important to connecting high degree people to each other, or I can be part of a little blob that seems genuinely peripheral and should be cut off. And I guess maybe my complaint about the peeling instability is it feels like I'm lumping removing those two kinds of low degree vertices together.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a very good point. Like we didn't do it on like anchored K cores. We should do it on the anchored K cores that I've been talking about. So maybe I can bring up a picture of the anchored K core here. We have this paper on it. Yeah, so when I say anchored K cores, is that, so here's an anchored K core, the green nodes form a three core. If the red node is anchored, the entire graph becomes an anchored K core. So this is a special node, and this is what you're talking about. And we didn't do this anchored K core in this analysis.
Okay.
Right? This in part talks about what you're getting at, right?
Yeah. I mean, if you were sort of anchoring the ones that seem to be structurally important.
Right.
What if you're the hardest?
Yeah. 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 Very good point. Yes.
Yes, I was wondering, so now there's like a static snapshot, and there is basically no assumption about the processes that goes on in this network. So I'm wondering if you have more of like many of these networks can be adaptive in the sense that they are, if you do something to them, they kind of adapt to this change. So how can this be kind of extended to when you view a network as actually adaptive? So they change the nodes, they change their edge weights. And can the similar analysis be made when you have not like this kind of static view of the network?
Yeah, I mean, as a computer scientist, I guess my answer to you would be, I like discretizing things. So I have Monday's graph, Tuesday's graph, Wednesday's graph, so on and so forth. And I can track the people that are important to me and see like how much their embedding changes over time. I think as a network scientist, I'm thinking, oh, perhaps I have some process on top of this network and that process is changing the weights on the edges in terms of like you pass me a piece of information and it happens to be true. And so now I trust you more so that like the weight score will go up more. But then that depends on whether like the information that you passed me was like symmetric or asymmetric transmission or whether it was a simple or complex contagion. Now I have to take all of this other things into account, which makes my job as a computer scientist harder. So you ask a very good question. Typically, what we would do would be something very naive, which I just told, like basically Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, whatever, and then see how the embeddings change and whatever, which is not very satisfying. And there's no like theoretical anything. It's just like, look, it works on this, you know. But the real answer would be like, one would need to work with a domain expert and see, okay, well, how are these processes being generated? And does it make sense that these embeddings make sense? And whether you want to embed based on, so taking the processes into account when you are embedding, right? As opposed to like here, we were just doing, oh, Tina is friend with Chris, right? Instead of, yes, Tina's friends with Chris and Chris told her 10 lies, right? That were symmetric and had like symmetric transmission and was simple contagion, right? And so, but I don't know of actually any embedding method that takes both the structure and the processing on top of it. That's harder, yeah.
But also, as you said, what makes an embedding good, if anything, is application dependent.
Yeah, yes, absolutely. So far it has been that we are looking at maybe like, can the embedding actually tell me about the process that's generating the network? You know, like, would it actually tell me something about, like what I'm really finding in this lower dimensional space is what God uses to connect people or whatever, you know? And I would find the mechanism by which, you know, these embeddings give rise to the network. That's more aspirational. Sorry, that I was just going to say that's more aspirational. Any other questions that I cannot answer? Because so far all the answers are like, oh, that's hard. We should have tried that. Yeah.
I'm trying to think through what's going on with the area under the curve looking so good and the community prediction
membership prediction of community membership
So
bad. And that seems to be a problem that's maybe related to the one you're discussing, but it looked like it was a persistent issue across all of the methods. And so like, what's the intuition for why the area under the curve would be so high, but the community membership would be so low?
I think that they're capturing more of the global structure as opposed to like this local structure of like, oh, these guys are in my community. And also if you think about link prediction, I know that the AUC can deal with like, oh, there's a class imbalance, so on and so forth. But it's just a matter of like, if I'm doing link prediction, I'm just doing reconstruction error, right? Versus if I'm going with a ranking, I'm doing that second order thing. Like if I go back to the, this one here.
This can also just happen because of a low base rate, right? I mean, if the graph is quite sparse.
It is, but they're usually not that sparse. Like for like computer scientists working on graphs, when we say sparse, we mean that every node has on the order of log n edges. So this is link prediction, right? So this is basically the reconstruction error for the adjacency matrix is link prediction. But for the ranking, I need this, right? That you and I were close in the graph, and so we should be close in the embedding space. And so for the ranking is where the precision at K is coming into it versus this, which is the link prediction one. So this is more global, right? I have the adjacency matrix, and now I embedded the nodes into this lower dimensional space, and now I reconstruct the adjacency matrix from the lower dimensional space. And how well did I do in the reconstruction? And that's link prediction. And this is the ranking.
But I guess just to make sure I understand, I'm going to ask a very naive question. But presumably, if my reconstruction error was zero, then I will also be perfect on the ranking. Or maybe I just don't understand exactly what the reconstruction error means.
I didn't think about it that way. Because what's happening with the precision at K is that as I think it was Chris who mentioned it, like you and I could be in the same community, right? But not have a link together. But we have a lot of other people who are connecting us, right? And like there's some other whatever and so on and so forth. So we could be in this dense subgraph, which we're calling it community, but not have a link together. So it's not so much about the links, the global link structure. It's more about, oh, you and I were close geodesically in this graph such that like there was more edge density between us and all these nodes here. But then like the people in the embedding space, the five people that are closest to me don't appear in this community, right?
Well, suppose I'm connected to 1% of people in the world,
mm-hmm.
but that everyone I am connected to is ranked in the top 10%, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So then my AUC is about 0.9.
But the top 10% to me though, right? Because these are all, it's not like, so what do you mean by top 10%? Because here I'm saying these are the five nodes that are the closest to this circle, right? And then look here and see what portion of this five nodes were also in this community.
So I guess So my precision at 10, say, could easily be that of the top 10 people that you predict to be neighbors of mine, only one of them is.
It's not that they're neighbor in the sense that they're closest to me in the embedded space, right?
Whatever your method is for predicting links, I guess I'm just saying that.
So
the simplest reason why you could have low precision, even though you have high AUC, is just a low base rate.
That to me still makes the most sense.
That's all I'm trying to. I mean,
it could be, but the precision at K, as I recall with Sesha's work, so it's not like, oh, here's a node that has a lot of neighbors. I do better at precision at K for this node than another node. I have to go back and look at his paper again.
Okay, all right.
I think this is why actually people within the node embedding method make a distinction between the first order proximity and second order proximity, this notion of actually having connection between you and me versus the overlap between us.
And then when you predict that you and I are in the same, when you predict that two nodes are in the same community, is this in a synthetic model where we know a ground truth, or is this, because if you have another pipeline for community detection,
you do
the different algorithms are going to only partly agree about who's in the same community, then that's an additional complication to scientific enterprise here.
Yes, it is. And I know that Aaron has this thing about there's no free lunch for the community detection, blah, 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 whatever. But yes, it does add some uncertainty. But you know, a lot of the community detection methods, so the answer is no. We didn't look at, I don't think Sesh, for in this work, we didn't look at it. I'm not sure. I don't recall Sesh's work now. Whether he actually looked at communities where he knew that like, oh, you and I are in a baseball club, right? Because also those tend to, even if you have labels, those also tend to be error prone, right? Because you and I could also belong into another community and like, why did I pick baseball as opposed to like the book club or something? But anything that will raise some doubt in people's mind in terms of these embeddings is a good thing. That's what we're trying to do.
Well, I mean, I guess the actual reason I'm asking is because it looks like none of them are really working that well with respect to this ranking.
Yeah.
So if we think the ranking is important, that probably means there's either this problem we should just give up on it, or there's like a lot of interesting work. But maybe the follow-up question I would have is, has anybody looked at the sparseness of the reconstructed adjacency matrix versus the real, because I imagine that if the network is relatively sparse, the community detection algorithms would be quite sensitive to, you know, just, you know, a 5% increase in the density of edges could wildly change from having, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 communities in the first graph to 10 or 15 communities in the second graph. Is that something people look at?
No, I don't know of anyone that has looked at. So that would be another thing to look at. Though I am reviewing a paper right now that is about this, so, but I haven't finished it yet. So maybe very soon.
All right, well, let's thank our speaker again.